Okay, so thank you everybody, and welcome to this presentation on Hallelujah, a 1 kilometer by 3.5 centimeter hologram. It's a white light transmission, achromatic hologram. TJ would be very proud as to how I made it, because it's a single beam. It doesn't have a spatial filter. There was no isolation system, and it was made in my bedroom. Well, half my bedroom. I was sleeping in the other half, and there was a partition. I'm going to get to the punchline early. This is how the hologram ended up being exhibited. It was in a triangular receptacle. The 1 kilometer hologram was just unwound. In some ways, it's like a holographic ticker tape. The theme is on Twitter, and the holographic imagery was just text. That was at the opening of the exhibition. I don't treat holograms reverently. I just see them as artifacts, and I wanted people to participate in the experience and the tactile nature and lift up the holograms. And often it went on the floor, and without even being told, a lot of people would just pick it up and put it back in the receptacle. On the opening night, there was an elderly lady that stepped back, and I could hear this crunch as she stepped on part of the hologram. I just reassured her not to worry, because there was still 999 meters of good hologram left. And so she seemed relieved at that. These are the main points from an art point of view. Is that the kilometer hologram was about Twitter, and the length relates to the endless nature of tweets. As I said, it encourages the tactile nature of touching the hologram, reading the hologram, and the disposable nature of the messages. And that's why I was quite happy for people just to throw it back in the container or let it overflow. It didn't matter. The important thing about Twitter is to realise that the addiction, and for a lot of people it is an addiction, that the addiction is in the response. It's not in the writing of the tweets. It's actually waiting for a response and replying to that. Similar to the addiction, if you like, of text messages on mobile phones, the way that people keep checking their mobile phones to respond and respond. The Twitters and tweets represented in the hologram, some of them were actual that I got off the Twitter sites, others I made up. The stages covered in the hologram involve early tweets, right up to recent tweets, which involve companies like Adley and Twittard, who actually get celebrities to endorse companies in their tweets. Okay, so the first half of this presentation is telling you how I actually made the hologram. Initially, when I got the grant, I'd put in to buy a film that was 3.5 centimetres wide by 20 metres. Then when I got the grant, I found out they no longer made that film anymore. So I ended up getting two rolls that were 30 metres by 1.1 metres. And so I found, after many experiments, that the best way to make this hologram work would be to expose it in essentially a meter square frames. And each of those frames had 30 tweets on one topic, and it included or needed to make 33 and a third of those frames, which would give me the kilometer. And it was on glass, and I just used an opaque pen to write all the tweets. This is the optical setup. The laser was about a metre and a half off the ground at about a 45 degree angle. There was one small sheet of defrosted glass, and then there was a larger sheet of defrosted glass. The hologram was lying on the floor. There was the top sheet of glass which had the text. There was a second sheet of clear glass underneath, and then there was the film, and then there was some MDF board, like a platform, and then there was carpet. So if there was any insulation, it probably was because of the carpet. The reason why I used two sheets of glass, because I had to keep lifting it up after each exposure to wipe off the text and write new text, and there's no way I would have been able to lift up a solid sheet of glass that was about 1.2 centimetres. I used a coherent compass laser. I didn't use a spatial filter because it took 3 or 4 months to make, and I was worried that it would keep getting out of alignment and I would have to keep adjusting the pinhole. So I decided to use 2 sheets of frosted glass. The first one didn't quite illuminate enough of the large plate, but in itself, it created speckle. The second sheet of frosted glass totally eliminated any speckle and smoothed out any aberrations from dust. I've since made laser holograms and reflection holograms with this setup. So I almost don't use a spatial filter anymore. The second sheet of glass was just sitting in a frame and a piece of string was around it, and there was a nail on a bit of a cupboard and that held it in place, and it was simply gravity that held that sheet of glass. That was the holographic glass sheet, the glass sheet with the text, 30 rows of text. There was a 2-minute exposure. Then I used my own developer called Zip1. As soon as the developer hits that film, it goes black immediately. I developed it for just 1 minute. That's the formula. The bleach is just the standard EDTA bleach. Somebody from the Holo forum kindly put it on HoloWiki, so the formula is on the net. I'm quite happy to give anybody that formula if they want. It's an extremely active developer, and I use it for both transmission and reflection holograms. Just a 2-minute wash, then a bleach. Great, don't even have to touch it. It took only a couple of minutes to bleach. Then the image was just checked. After I washed it, essentially I used to take it into the shower, just undress, and I'd have a shower, and I'd wash the hologram at the same time. And then I would check it. That's what the film looked like when it was hanging up to dry. When I put a black curtain behind it, you can clearly see that what happens is that you have a shadow image of the text at the plane of the hologram, and the text itself projects out about 1.2 centimeters from the film, which is essentially the thickness of the 2 sheets of glass, and it projects in front. Those 1,000 tweets, if you like, then had to be cut up. That's where a lot of the work took place. So each of those strips was 1 meter by 3.5 centimeters, and there were 1,000 of those, and I just laminated them all together. That's not quite 1 kilometer, I have to confess. That's about 800 meters. When I took it to the gallery, I was still laminating furiously the last 200 meters. When I wound it all together, it was actually just a little less than 70 centimeters in diameter. I must admit, I had no idea how wide it would actually be when I was making it, but it was just under 70 centimeters when it was totally together. That was the flyer that went out with the exhibition that happened in February, March of this year. I exhibited other holograms, some stereograms that I'd made at Holographic Norths, and some other holograms. And again, that's how it was lit up. And that's what it looked like to the viewer. They would hold up. Because of the triangular arrangement, 3 people could get around, and look at it together. There was one light for each. And you could just pick up any of the text. Out of the 33 and a third frames, I didn't have any that didn't work. Fortunately, they all worked. I took my students along so I could make it all tax deductible. And it was good to get their feedback and how they worked with it and picked it up and would read it and would make comments to each other. If you go on the Twitter site, they'll tell you, essentially, they see themselves as a conduit between the people that tweet and the people that answer, and they see themselves as the organisation that gets people together and allows people to communicate. If you go onto Adley's site, they'll actually tell you they're the company that gets celebrities and endorsements together into the public. And they'll actually tell you that, in fact, they write the tweets for the celebrities. The celebrities don't write them. If you're somebody like Kim Kardashian, you'll get $10,000 for not even writing the tweet. And you can tell when it's an Adley tweet because there'll be a prefix that says bit.ly. And what happens is that these people will end up writing some tweets, and then every now and then there's a tweet that's written by Adley. They send a copy to the celebrities, get them to OK, and then they'll put it in and put $10,000 in the case of Kim Kardashian. I believe rumour has it that Charlie Sheen made quite a few million dollars from Adley during his crazy time, when in fact he had so many followers that he got quite a lot of endorsements. Adley won't sign you up unless you have at least 25,000 followers. TwitAd is another one. They're just upfront about it. They just say, if you've got friends, use them. They're money to you. And they make it all seem okay. There are a lot of companies like that. They, from their point of view, if you're on Twitter, if you're having fun tweeting, you might as well make some money while you're doing it. And they don't see anything wrong with that, which is fine. What the problem I have with it, it's what they call in-stream advertising. The idea is that you go onto some sites and you see an advertisement first and you get the option to skip it. Of course, they know most people skip that today. You go onto a site and you see the advertisements around the peripheral. The way around it now is what they call in-streaming. They put it in the content so that you have to read it. And people like Kim Kardashian and Charlie Sheen, they'll put in about one to half a dozen of these tweets every day. You can always tell because they'll say things like, the other day, Charlie Sheen was giving people the impression that he actually reads, because he was saying, I'm halfway through this book and you ought to check it out. And as soon as you see check it out, you know that you should get suspicious. And what it is a link to the sites. And they have the data to know that all the number of people that actually link and go and visit these sites. I don't mind. It's just the underhanded way in which it's done, in that they're not necessarily upfront about telling you who's reading the tweets if you're a follower of these people. I'm not on Twitter myself, by the way. That's the way it happens. I thought this was really interesting from an anonymous tweeter who thought rather naively that Twittering was all about communicating with real people. And for a lot of people, I think Twitter is about communicating with real people. But there's this other side where Twitter has developed, like all these social networking sites, and it's developed to the point where the tweeters and the Twitterers, there's a market there. And it's the idea that you're possibly being manipulated without being aware of it. So in summary, Hallelujah was really an excuse to look at the life and times of these social networking sites. It followed on from the work that I've been doing in the last 5 or 6 years about what I call fashionable communication technologies, mobile phones, cell phones, virtual realities, texting. And so this time, Hallelujah gave me an opportunity to look at something really specific. in this case Twitter, but it could apply, of course, to social networking sites as a whole. Thank you, people.
Any questions for David?
How heavy was the big
Bit heavy. No, it was okay. It wasn't. I mean, I wasn't grunting and groaning as I was carrying it from the car to the gallery, but it was okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Question was, how heavy was the 1 kilometer? Well, no, the glass.
The glass itself. The sheets of glass was okay because they were just 6 mil thick, and I found that was manageable. But I was worried initially because using the two sheets of glass, I was worried about a lot of internal reflections that might have happened. But tests showed that wasn't a factor at all, so it was easy to do. But as I said, I wanted the two sheets of glass because I wanted the text to at least project a certain distance. But if it was much bigger than that, because of the angle of the light, the text that was at the top part of the sheet would have been projected beyond the emulsion on the sheet. So I found that distance was fine. Yes, you can just go along to stationery stores and you can buy sheets of laminating material. You can just cold laminate it, you just cut it into strips. So I just cut it into 3.5 centimeter strips and just cut it, and you just cold laminate it with a bit of a roller. So there's no heat involved. It's just that I did that 1,000 times.
So. How'd you come up with the name Zip Sister for your site?
Many, many years ago, I was busily distracted and I watched a film called RoboCop. And I heard something, and I thought that the person had said "Zip Sister." It wasn't actually what he said. He was actually taking a leak at the time, and he said something else. He actually said, "Do you mind? I'm taking a piss, sister." All right. But I thought he had said "Zip Sister." I thought that sounds like a good name. I think I'll remember that some stage. I'm sure that'll come in handy. And when I made up the website, that's where it came from. It certainly sounds better than "Piss Sister." I don't think that somehow would have gone down the same.
Let's use the microphone so that everyone can hear.
Why did you decide to handwrite the tweets instead of putting them in a font?
I just like that personal touch. But drawing the lines, you'll notice I had the lines there. That made it easier to sort of at least have the text fairly straight. And I had to do that because I wanted to fit a maximum amount that I could into each of those frames. And 30 was just the right amount. And 3.5 centimeter width was a width that I decided on long before because I thought that was going to be the sort of film the width that I was going to be buying anyway. And that just seemed to be a nice size to actually write the text and still be seen, not too big, not too small. It actually took longer actually erasing it at the end of each because it was an opaque pen and they're almost sort of waterproof and everything else. It would take me at least half an hour to an hour just to scrub it off. I'd get maybe one, maybe two done a night.
Move on. Thank you, David.